In 2009, before the first cryptocurrency had been created, and long before stablecoins or CBDCs had even been conceptualized, the global telephony company Webtel.mobi, or WM, had already developed the world's first fully functional and globally operational digital currency. But rather than rush to market, WM decided to limit its global operations to a restricted user group and spent years testing and refining the digital currency to make sure that it would be compliant with all necessary legal, regulatory, and security requirements before commencing unrestricted global operations with it. In 2018, after 9 years of fully operational testing worldwide, including over 30 due diligences, WM had perfected its digital currency for unrestricted global use. It then took down its Platform 1 and spent 3 years building its Platform 2, which platform incorporated all refinements required to maximize the versatility of its digital currency and other facilities. These included refinements to its TUV digital currency, a refined and compliant digital currency that renders all cryptocurrencies and stablecoins redundant and supersedes CBDCs before they have even been developed. Its ICLM transfers, a transfer system superior to the SWIFT system. Its ICLM payments, the world's first centrally controlled unitary global payment system. Its currency swaps, a currency conversion mechanism that provides a superior and P2P alternative to the current global FX market. The WM International Clearing System. This is the integrated WM platform functioning as an international clearing system, and multiple other versatile and multi-use facilities on the WM platform. Given the potential geostrategic capacities of the WM system, as well as the volumes of the values of the global markets that it was preparing to access and serve through the launch of the new Platform 2, WM provided the Levy Economics Institute of Bard College in the United States with the opportunity to thoroughly review its system. This included analyzing the theoretical grounding of the WM system and its practical applications, as well as providing an assessment of the WM system's potential impact on the operation and efficiency of the international financial system. The Levy Economics Institute is an economic research organization that many people consider to be one of the most authoritative, if not the most authoritative, economic and macroeconomic research organizations in the world. As an indication of its level of seniority, the Levy Economics Institute hosts an annual meeting between its members and the heads of the banks of the Federal Reserve System, senior U.S. and international regulatory organizations, heads of European and other international central banks, and international leaders from the financial sector. Among the Levy Economics Institute's 76 scholars and boards of governors are current and former heads of economics faculties and senior professors of economics from over 60 universities worldwide. Its current and former scholars and governors include Nobel laureates in economics, former governors of central banks, former ministers of finance, and current or former senior personnel of the World Bank and International Monetary Fund. The director of research at the Levy Economics Institute, Professor Jan Kregel, led the investigation of the WM facilities and system. Professor Kregel is a leading international economist, having been a professor or visiting professor of economics at over 20 universities worldwide. He's also advised various governments and central banks around the world, published a number of books, and received honors and awards related to his more than 5 decades of work in the field of economics. Importantly, one of Professor Kregel's former advisory roles was as chief rapporteur of the Commission of Experts of the President of the UN General Assembly on reforms of the international monetary and financial system. As such, he is possibly the most authoritative person in the world to examine new facilities and systems that potentially reform global financial and economic systems. During his year-long research and investigation of the WM system and its facilities, Professor Kregel published 5 research papers on the WM system's capacities. 3 of these research papers were published via the Levy Economics Institute and 2 independently. All of these research papers have been made public on the Levy Economics Institute's website and WM's platform. In this interview in September 2021, Professor Kregel provides summarized comments on some of the conclusions reached as a result of his research of the WM system and facilities.
My name is Jan Kregel. I'm here at the Levy Economics Institute, where I'm the director of research. The Institute has 76 scholars, linked around the globe that work with the idea of providing what we believe is nonpartisan, non-political, and nonprofit research, which is meant not only to inform the policy-making process, but also effectively to bring together both academics, national policymakers, politicians, legislators, and formal regulators in the financial and the economic system to discuss a wide range, the widest possible range, of alternative economic theories and economic policies that are based on those particular theories. So the, if you like, the leitmotif of the Institute is that we have to be able to discriminate between economic theories and to link them to economic policy proposals. And basically, as a research institute, that's what we're involved in doing. So every year we have a international conference on the state of the U.S. and the global economies, in which we bring together, for example, presidents of the Reserve Banks of the Federal Reserve, practitioners who are part of the regulatory process in the Congress, the members of the Federal Reserve, and the various other regulatory agencies of the U.S. government, the members of the Council of the European Central Bank and various other central banks around the world. And the idea is that these regulators, these officials, should be mixing with academics in order to understand the economic theories that are being discussed and proposed, and also with the general public and practitioners. We always have a large number of financial analysts and officials in financial institutions. So the idea is that we're supposed to be bringing together all of these various types of ideas and to analyze their impact on the performance of the economy. And the basis of that analysis is that, in fact, the financial system that functions in most capitalist economies is one that does produce frequent financial crises and therefore requires analysis of the theory and policy of regulation to try and prevent those crises. I'm the director of a special program that we have within this institute on monetary policy and financial structure. The thrust of this particular program, as I mentioned, is to look at the performance and the cyclical performance and the instability of the economy over time. And in that particular context, the work that we do is centered on a number of proposals that were made by John Maynard Keynes, a well-known English economist, who participated in the creation of the Bretton Woods system. And the Bretton Woods system was basically the international financial system that was created in 1944 and survived more or less intact until the mid-1970s. My own academic career started in the late 1960s, so I lived through the collapse of the Bretton Woods system. I have been employed through a rather long career in the private sector, in the public sector, and have been a professor and have been an advisor to business, an advisor to governments, and most recently served as the rapporteur for the report on the reform of the financial system, which was mandated by the President of the General Assembly after the 2007-2008 crisis. So basically, my work has been on a global scale. I've taught in Italy, I've taught in France, I've taught in Belgium, and worked for a number of private sector institutions in those countries, as well as here in the United States and at the Levy Institute. So I try to bring a global or an international perspective to all of these items. And in particular, as a result of the work that we did in the United Nations, have tried to focus on reform of the international financial system. Indeed, when my first participation in the process of financing for development, which was launched within the United nations after the 1997 crisis by Bill Clinton, when he argued that it was necessary to have a reform of the international financial architecture. I was the representative of a major UN organization at the Monterey Conference on Financing for Development, and then we obviously had a second financial crisis after 97 in 2007-2008, and this led to the president of the General Assembly calling together a group to provide a report on the reform of the system. So basically, my recent work has been involved in trying to provide proposals to implement an alternative, theoretical, and policy system for the international economy. So one of the areas in which I have been particularly interested and active has been in terms of the international financial regulation and the reform of the international financial system. In the Bretton Woods discussions, basically there were two alternatives which were discussed. One was a stabilization fund or a reserve system, which was promoted by the United States. Maynard Keynes provided an alternative proposal, which was for a clearing union. And that clearing union was based on an idea that had existed in economic theory for some time. So much of my research has been in terms of investigating the theoretical background to this alternative approach and whether that alternative approach could in fact be implemented. Now, one of the basic areas here is that it is widely considered that the Bretton Woods system collapsed in the 1970s because it was based on a national currency, that is basically the US dollar. Simply, the Bretton Woods system used the dollar to replace gold. Now, the clearing union proposal does not require a national currency in order to function. And this is one of the attractive parts of this alternative proposal, is that it means that you don't need a particular national currency as the center of the international financial system. Why is this important? Well, it's important because every country considers its domestic monetary policy as a national requirement. So that obviously the Federal Reserve is going to undertake monetary policy in order to satisfy the requirements of stability in the United States system. This may not be the policies that are required for international stability. It may be that international stability requires an alternative type of monetary policy. Now, as a natural offshoot of this, when the creation of digital currencies was first proposed, it created the possibility of saying, well, perhaps this is the time that we can make the shift from the US dollar as the center of the international financial system to something else. So the first question that had to be confronted was whether a digital currency was the most appropriate way to do this. The existence of digital currencies provided a possibility for an alternative approach, so that it became very obvious that the reform proposals would have to be linked somehow or other to what has become a very rapidly emerging sector in terms of international finance, in terms of digital currencies. Now, the digital currencies have a number of basic differences from the normal financial system. First of all, they do not represent national currencies and are not integrated amongst themselves. In fact, they are, in a sense, international. That is, anyone who owns a digital currency, say, for example, a Bitcoin, doesn't have an American Bitcoin or a Belgian Bitcoin. A Bitcoin is a Bitcoin. It doesn't have any national boundary. At the same time, because it doesn't have a national boundary, it has no national regulation. That is, exists outside of the normal regulatory mechanisms. So that obviously the existence of digital currencies raised a number of issues in terms of integration of the international financial system, in terms of the role of national regulators and the terms of regulation per se in the implementation of the system. So obviously I was drawn to analysis of what the existence of these digital currencies, or what Now, this fit with the existing work that I had undertaken from the breakdown of Bretton Woods in the 1970s, and this was the application of Keynes' alternative proposal for Bretton Woods, which was for an international clearing system. And it became very obvious that the idea of, electronic currency or digital currency provided a way of implementing this international clearing union, because Keynes' system was in fact one that did not require a national currency. National currencies continued to exist, but it was not a national currency that was at the center of the system. In fact, if we look at that clearing union system, it managed to eliminate the necessity of having a single global currency. So it became plausible to introduce some sort of global system based on a system of digital or electronic currencies. So the first question that had to be confronted was whether a digital currency was the most appropriate way to do this. For example, Bitcoin being the first of the digital currencies, the question is, would Bitcoin become a possible substitute for the dollar? Well, analysis showed us pretty quickly that the Bitcoin, while it was engaged in some early reticence in being adopted, eventually became very popular. But it became very popular because its value fluctuated. That is, it became a speculative currency rather than a currency of stability. So this meant that Bitcoin was probably not the most appropriate type of substitute. The next alternative was for central banks, who said, well, if Bitcoin, being a private currency, is outside of our regulation, perhaps we don't want Bitcoin as the center of the system, because not only is it unstable, but we have no possibility of regulating or implementing monetary policy to control the impact of Bitcoin on the system. So perhaps we should think about instituting our own currencies. Now, this creates an alternative problem. That is, central banks normally create what we call central bank money. That is, accounts that trade amongst financial institutions. They don't trade amongst individuals. That is, you can't go to your local Federal Reserve Bank and say, I would like to open an account with the Federal Reserve Bank. So the question is how the bank would go about doing this. And in the end, it turns out that if you think of the central bank having to substitute for all of the individual banks in the system, there are some, if memory serves me right, 4,000 individual banks, to substitute for all of those accounts, obviously the Federal Reserve is not equipped and not capable to take over that particular possibility unless it manages to generate a very large contribution from the United States Congress in order to amplify its expenditures. So the second source turns out to be really not a very sensible way of pursuing this clearing union. So as I was pursuing the research on this particular area, I discovered the WM system, or the Webtel.mobi system, which provided an alternative to the digital currency proposals. So about a year and a half ago, I discovered the existence of the Webtel.mobi system, and I started investigating how the system functioned. And I will have to say, to a certain extent, was amazed that it was a almost virtual mirror of the system that Keynes himself had proposed for an international clearing system. So obviously, I became very interested in the WM system as a possible method of providing the reform of the international financial system. I then produced a number of papers, all of which have been produced on the Levy Institute website, to set out the advantages of using this type of system as the reform of the international financial system. Now, if we look at the WM system is born inside an international mobile telephone system. Now, this makes sense. Why? Because virtually all financial systems are now systems of messaging. That is, they're sending messages. Okay? If I make a payment, I send a message to my bank. I don't, in fact, go and pick up some gold and take it to the person I want to pay. I don't anymore write a check or send the check. I simply send a message to the bank. The bank sends a message to someone else. So it makes perfectly good sense that if financial transactions are all messaging, that they should be done inside of some sort of messaging system. And mobile telephone systems are basically that, messaging systems. So I was drawn to the WM system because it provided the possibility of introducing Kane's system on a global level, and it provided advantages that the digital currencies and the cryptocurrencies don't have. First of all, because the Webtel system functions on a payments mechanism or a payments unit called the TUV, which is linked directly to the US dollar. So it is by definition stable. Its value doesn't change. Now, we know that if you have a Bitcoin, the value goes up and down. We know that if you have even what is called a stable coin, such as the Tether, the value goes up and down. You are never sure whether the value is going to be more or less. This is very inconvenient if you're making payments, because payments have to be made in precise amounts. And if I'm making a payment in one type of cryptocurrency and the value of the currency changes while I'm making the payment, then the payment may not go through. So there is a very, very large, sharp advantage involved in having the stability that the WM system provides. It provides a perfectly stable value to your payment unit. The payment union is perfectly stable in terms of dollars. At the same time, you can have an account which is in any international currency. It remains stable in that international currency, but it also provides you with the possibility of exchanging across currencies at virtually zero cost and virtually instantaneously. Because the system is global, that is, you have the possibility of opening your account and taking TUVs in any global currency, you also have the possibility of making payments to individuals who are in other financial jurisdictions. You may make those payments in your own currency, or you may exchange your currency for any other currency. Now, this takes place precisely the same way as you make a payment. That is, you offer to exchange currency, your currency, for any foreign currency. Say you're trying to trade between the dollar and the euro. You put a message on the system which says, I am willing to exchange dollars for euro. Will someone make a bid? And then individuals who are looking to exchange euros for dollars will access the system and will provide for you their offer. And if you find it acceptable, you simply click on the website and the transaction takes place, again, automatically, so that your foreign currency transaction takes place just as rapidly as a transaction in domestic currency. The rate at which it takes place is the rate which is determined, obviously, amongst individuals. Okay, this is what we call a voluntary transaction. If the exchange rate is satisfactory to me and it's satisfactory to you, then the exchange takes place. And you can't do any better than that in the financial market, because if you do it through the formal banking system, the formal banking system is going to charge you fees and commissions. So it provides this advantage of being extremely rapid, extremely efficient, and also at minimal, absolutely minimal cost. So it does provide a substitute for international payments as well as national payments, and thus provides, as I mentioned, the basis for setting up an international system. If we look at the existing financial system, we know that there is what we call financial exclusion. Not everyone can participate in the system. If we look at the WM system, all you need is a cell phone, and not even a smartphone. That is, you don't have to download some complicated app to use the system. The system works automatically no matter what sort of cell phone that you have, so that it provides you the possibility of not having to open a bank account. So the system provides a substantial saving to people who, for example, number one, want more rapid transactions, but also for that part of the unbanked population, it avoids the necessity of paying fees for that bank account. It gives you the possibility of making direct person-to-person payments for people who are verified through a process of know your client and anti-money laundering, so that you're protected against loss, that is virtually instantaneous, that is, transactions are made because they're done in terms of a what we call a clearing system or a netting system. My account is debited at the same time your account is credited. So the payment takes place virtually instantaneously. Now, we know Einstein told us that there's no possibility of anything happening simultaneously, but this is as close as you can get. So the payments take place instantaneously. You know that if you make a payment now, the money is there, and it is done at much lower cost, and in many cases at zero cost, so that you have financial savings, you have efficiency, and you have safety and security of the system. It's impossible to lose the funds because somebody leaves with them, and this is because all of the funds that you have deposited in the system are in fact directly linked to a regulated account which is supported by a national safety net system, either a deposit insurance system or a bailout system from a national regulator. So it provides all of these advantages which a digital currency or a cryptocurrency will not provide, and in fact cannot provide. Now, the one advantage relative to the WM system that you might get from a cryptocurrency, as we see daily, the value of cryptocurrencies go up, the value of Bitcoin in dollars goes up, the value of other currencies goes up. The problem is that they also go down. And very recently, one of the most highly traded stable coins posted on the website, the value of the coin today is zero, which means that you've lost all of the money that you've used in order to buy that particular stable coin. This cannot happen with the TUV in the WM system. At the same time, we read about these systems being hacked. The exchanges that trade cryptocurrencies back and forth managed to lose substantial amounts of funds. These are funds that you can never get back. But under the WM system, because it is subject to national security mechanisms, you can always recover funds should they happen to go missing. But it's virtually impossible for funds to go missing in this system because they are always one-to-one transfers from one person's account to another person's account. And the only way you could use the money is if you, in fact, are transferring to someone, okay, who is a fictitious person or a fraudulent person. And this is avoided by the fact that everybody who participates in the system has to provide identity, guarantees under the Know Your Client system, and under the anti-money laundering system, so that you know precisely the persons who are receiving the funds on the other side. So it becomes a perfectly secure system. The last problem with the crypto system is that once you've made your fortune in Bitcoin, you have to be able to use that Bitcoin to do something. I'm a multimillionaire in Bitcoin. If I can't spend it on anything, it's virtually useless to me. So effectively, if you look at the way the cryptocurrency functions, as someone once said, most of the people here learned their monetary theory by playing Super Mario Brothers and collecting tokens. Now, the problem is those tokens are very good for Mario, but they're not very good if you're trying to buy something in the actual financial system. Now, the other advantage that you have of the system is that once you think of financial transactions as simply being messages, then it's possible to engage in all sorts of international transactions. It's not only transactions in terms of currency or in terms of current payments, but you could create delayed payments. Delayed payments are what? Well, delayed payments are if my son decides that he's out of money, I can advance to him money that he can use today and he can pay back in the future, which is effectively the process of granting a loan. So we have the equivalent of what we now call the P2P, the person-to-person private sector lending system. That is, if you're familiar with the way the P2P system has gone, there have been substantial difficulties in which funds which have been transferred end up going missing. Well, in the Webtel system, they cannot go missing, because the funds are always there and they're always dollar backed. So from that particular point of view, we can say the Webtel system provides the basis for a fully functioning international financial system in which we don't have to have a common national currency. It is much more rapid, it is cheaper, and it is much more stable and does not run the risk of the possibility of loss of funds. As we know, recently we read every day of exchanges for crypto systems being hacked and money being lost. In this particular case, because it's a system that is run centrally and it's always fully backed, it is always possible to restore and to trace the funds that have lost and have gone missing. First, the system has the advantage of stability. And that stability is the same as having a regular US dollar account. Secondly, it is extremely efficient and rapid. It is much more rapid than the existing financial system and any other transfer system. It is also cheaper because the fees and commissions do not exist in these systems because they're a direct transfer system. It also provides you with the ability to exchange globally in any currency that you like, at exchange rates which are almost always more competitive than the exchange rates in financial markets, because you're not paying fees and commissions. And it is perfectly secure and stable because it is backed up by the existing state-of-the-art methods for providing know your client and anti-money laundering mechanisms. So this is the basic, as I said, the basic advantage which I found in this particular system, and was very happy to work out these various research papers in order to point out how the system could in fact not only serve as the basis for the existing payment system, but could also provide the basis for a number of additional aspects. I've already mentioned the possibility of P2P lending, that is providing loans. You could also have the possibility of the exchange of equity. That is, we can exchange shares on a person-to-person basis amongst account holders in the Webtel system. And again, because the Webtel system is fully regulated, that is, it engages fully in the what we call the KY system, the Know Your Client system, and the AML system, the anti-money laundering system. It satisfies all of the national requirements of all the countries in which the system participates, so that you are fully covered by the maximum extent of security of any particular national system. And this is something which none of the cryptocurrencies, none of the stable coins, Bitcoin, or any of the other digital payment mechanisms can provide. So it's a perfectly safe system. And on these grounds, the WM system is clearly the best available international payments mechanism that exists.